Good evening, everyone. My seniors and esteemed faculty members, I am extremely honored and I feel privileged to have been given this opportunity to address everyone on this platform. We are here to discuss about the adolescent's health. Adolescence is the phase of life between childhood and adulthood, that is between 10 to 19 years of age, and it's an important time for laying the foundation of good health. Adolescents experience rapid physical, cognitive, and psychosocial growth, and this affects their way of thinking and decision-making and interaction with the outside world. Despite being thought of as a healthy stage, there is illness and significant deaths in these adolescents' year. And the fact is that much of this is preventable and treatable also. So today we are here to throw light on two important topics of the adolescent health. That is abnormal uterine bleeding in adolescents, which is a challenging and often neglected topic. Dr. Payal Chaudhary will be throwing light on this. And the second topic is anemia and teenage pregnancy, which will be shared by Dr. Panchamprit Kaur. I would like to introduce Dr. Anita Rajoria, ma'am, who is the chairperson of the Adolescent Health Committee. Without ma'am's motivation and unconditional support, this webinar would not have been possible. I will just introduce ma'am. Ma'am has very kindly given the opportunity to our institute and our people to share their thoughts on adolescent health. Ma'am, a very warm welcome to you. Ma'am is presently the senior consultant and HOD in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Hospitals. Ma'am has several affiliations with the Asia and Oceania Federation of Obs and Gyne, the Federation of Obs and Gyne of India, the AOGD, Delhi Gyne Forum, NARCHI.
Thank you, Nikita. I think that is sufficient.
Okay, ma'am.
So, welcome, dear delegates and my respected faculty, Dr. Achala ma'am, Girish sir, respected Rakesh sir, dear Mala, and all my dear speakers, Payal. And another speaker is joining soon. So it is my proud privilege to welcome Achala ma'am. She is the president AOGD for giving her inaugural address. And I am happy in sharing with you the fact that this current CME has been given two ICOG credit points. So I thank ICOG chairperson, Dr. Uday Thanewala, Dr. Parag Viniwale, and Dr. Ashok Kumar for honoring us with these two ICOG points. So, introducing Achala ma'am, she is the...
That's okay, Rita. I think I know everybody.
She's a very supportive president and she's always there for us. So, over to you, Achala ma'am.
Thank you, Anita. Thank you very much. And I'm very happy that Adolescent Health Committee has taken out these two very important topics of anemia and AUB in adolescence. And you have with, the chairperson of FOCSI Adolescent Committee, Dr. Girish Mane. Welcome, Dr. Girish. You have Mala and you have my two bachas, Nikita and Payal, who have become, big shots now. And they would be talking about the AUB problems. The adolescent is a period when, a lot of care is required. That is the time you can make them or you can, not do anything for them. And, the pillar of their life, pillar of the nation, that gets spoiled. And anemia, we know, is the problem in our country. I mean, I've been practicing obstetrics for 40 years and there is a difference in anemia, but if you take the percentage of people being anemic, maybe they are less who are severely anemic, but still anemia problem has not changed much. So we want to do anemia more thorough. But for that, we have to start from very beginning. And adolescence is the time when we can catch them in schools. So that is the time, we can catch them, give them supplements and also teach them, good habits of food. And the AOB takes the toll, even if they are all right, they become anemic because of this adolescent AOB problem. Both the topics are very good and we will all learn something new, or if not new, we will be reiterating whatever we know. So I wish you a very, very, you know, successful day.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for those encouraging words. Nikita, can you share the CV of respected Girish, sir? Our another guest of honor is none other than Dr. Girish Mane, sir, is the chairperson of Adolescent Health Committee, FOCSI. And sir is also a very encouraging chairperson. He has great interest in all adolescent health issues. Sir has been past president of Yavatmal OBGYN Society, past chairperson Adolescent Gynae Committee, AMOG. He has been awarded best chairperson AMOG 18-20, recipient of FOCSI Smriti Mailan Save Baby Girl Runner-Up Award, Best Society AMOG Award. And sir has been recipient of Dr. Durusha Youth Trophy and Dr. Sadhana Desai Award in 2017. He was the first winner of FOCSI Talent Singing Contest. I must share with
thank you. Thank you very much, madam.
Great singer.
Thank you so much.
So over to you, Girish, sir. Yes.
Thank you. Once again, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And I would like to express my sincere thanks and gratitude to Dr. Achala Bhadra, madam, AOGD president, and Dr. Anita Rajuria, who is the chairperson of Adolescent Health Committee of AOGD. And all the organizers, and I again welcome the chairpersons for today's function, Dr. Mala Srivastava, madam, then Dr. Sujata Das, and Dr. Rakesh Taneja, and the eminent speakers, Dr. Payal, who is going to speak on AOB in adolescent, which is a very important and very practical aspect. I know everything will be very well explained by Dr. Payal, but the only thing which should always be kept in the mind that there is a little bit difference in the girl who is having AUB, and especially the HMB, that is heavy menstrual bleeding, because of the blood disorders. Because these girls, they will start bleeding heavily right from their menarche. And if such kind of girls, they have been identified because of the family history or because of the history of excessive bleeding in some other surgeries or in some other instances, then such girls should be prepared mentally. Not only the girls, but the family should be counseled properly, should be prepared mentally for the heavy bleeding in their menarche, and they should be given the complete knowledge about that. And the help of the hematologist should be always taken in, especially in these girls who are the probable candidates for having the HMB because of the blood disorders, or who are the diagnosed cases of these blood disorders. Now, coming to the teenage pregnancy, it is always the bestest and most important, a topic of my interest, that is POXO. Yesterday, we had very little or less talk about POXO, which is very important. And friends, take my words, out of all 10 girls in India, 7 are anemic. And I always cover one point in my talk, that many girls, only because of ignorance of their anemia, they are having decreased memory, loss of interest in the studies, and in spite of so much of ability, they cannot make their performances in their academics, and that's why they may get diverted from their very good this future. And many girls, if only they are aware of the fact that they can be patient of anemic, and if their families are properly counseled, they can have a great future in life, not only the academic but even the obstetrical future. Because most of the disorders, for example the PPH or many things, they are worsened only because of presence of anemia. For example, if a female is landing up in the PPH or in a shock at the loss of 1000 ml of the blood, the person who is already anemic will land up in those crises only with the loss of 600 or 700 ml of the blood. So I congratulate Anita madam for choosing very great topics for today's discussion. And I again extend my best wishes to both the speakers and the chairperson. And I wish happy learning to all of you. Thank you once again, and keep inviting me in the future also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Girish sir. Very truly highlighted. Today only I had a patient who was 17 years, claims to be 17 year old. She looks much younger, maybe around 14 or 15. She came alone, fully dilated. So she doesn't even remember her relative's address and nothing like that. Thankfully, she could attend the maternity at the time of labor. The baby is IUGR, preterm. So these unfortunate cases we are often encountering in our obstetrical practice. So over to you, Nikita, for the scientific session now. Thank you, Girish sir and Ashla ma'am. Thank you for your encouraging words.
Thank you, madam. Thanks a lot.
Before Nikita takes over, I would like this to invite you all to the AOGD Annual Conference 19th to 21st November. You're going to get a very good extravaganza of academics and people like Nicolaides and Rani Thakre, they are coming for the conference. I mean, virtually, of course. So please do register for the conference.
Sure.
Thank you, ma'am. Let's begin our scientific session. So our first session is abnormal uterine bleeding in adolescents. For this, I would like to invite our respected chairpersons for the session. First of all, I would like to invite Dr. Mala Srivastava, ma'am. She is a senior consultant and professor at Sir Gangaram Institute. She has keen interest in gyne-oncology, gyne-endoscopic surgery, and gyne-robotic surgery. Ma'am is a fellow of minimal access surgery, and she's trained in robotic surgery, France. She has been a member of numerous committees. She has been awarded the APJ Abdul Kalam Excellence Award. And I welcome you, ma'am, for this session. Next, I would like to invite Dr. Sujata Das, ma'am. She is the Chief Medical Officer at PMMC and Safdarjung Hospital, Delhi. The keen areas of interest of ma'am are preventive oncology and gyne endoscopy. And she has been specially trained in fellowship in gyne endoscopy and colposcopy, ultrasonology. And ma'am has many publications, and she has been awarded outstanding performance in cervical screening at NARCHI National Conference 2019. I would like to request Dr. Mala Srivastava, ma'am, to say a few words and also invite our first speaker for the session, Dr. Payal Chaudhary, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. It's my pleasure and privilege to be a part of this scientific program. Adolescent is a very tender age, and we have to take care of our adolescent girls. It's my privilege to welcome the star speaker of the evening, Dr. Payal Chaudhary. She is a senior consultant at Sitaram Bhartiya Hospital, and she is going to speak about AUB in adolescent. Dr. Payal has a keen interest in adolescent health, urogynecology, minimally access surgery, and she has appreciation to quite a few societies. Over to you, Dr. Payal, for your scientific deliberation. We are waiting to hear from you.
Good evening, everyone, all the esteemed chairpersons, the guests who are present. It's indeed an honor to be talking on this important topic about, AUB in adolescent. And, without further ado, I'll start with the topic. Adolescence, we all know, is a time of opportunities and woes. So that is the topic we're going to. It's a phase of life from 10 to 19. It's a unique stage of human development. And we lay foundation of good health at this time. Adolescents experience rapid physical, cognitive, and psychological growth at this time, and learn important life skills at the present time. It is supposed to be time of peak health, but it is also the time when adolescents go through so much changes, and if one is not careful, they land up with health issues that last them for life. And to grow and develop in good health, they need age-appropriate, comprehensive sexual education, opportunity to develop life skills, health services that are acceptable, equitable, and appropriate, and safe and supportive environments. And I think we are the key players in this who can make a difference. In fact, according to WHO data, out of 7.2 billion people worldwide, 42% people fall under the age of 25, and that's a huge number. And around 1.2 billion people are actually just adolescents, 10 to 19 year olds. And they need to have access to healthcare, which is equitable. We need to make them feel welcome when they come, because I think for an adolescent to come to the hospital for seeking care is a huge deal. So if we become the carriers of, positivity for them, they don't feel judged by us. They don't feel that that, you know, they will be unheard of. We will have more people coming in for seeking help. And that'll make a huge, huge difference, especially with teenage pregnancy coming into the scenario. If people come to us on time, they can be helped with timely care and prevention of, as sir also said, Dr. Girish, you know, avoiding anemia in this age group. And I'll not go into the details of adolescent development, but yes, by the time they start with puberty, there is a lot of stress on their preoccupation with the parents. Then comes complete puberty between 15 to 17, and 18 and older is when physical reproductive maturity comes. And that holds true for the menstrual cycle also. Initially, the cycles may be anovulatory, meaning the cyclical hormonal changes that are to happen, that is estrogen rising in the first part of the cycle, then after ovulation, the progesterone rise. We all are familiar with this image. I think we've grown up with this image from the start of our, you know, study days, and how the pituitary hormones make a difference and the LH surge that happens, which causes ovulation. But this does not happen from the start of when a girl starts with menarche. And although, you know, it is basically the anovulation is first thing that is primarily there, and there is immaturity of the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis, which leads to irregular periods in the start. The length could be anywhere between 21 to 45 days, and the cycle days could be 7 days or even fewer than that. And that's normal for them. The age-related interval, that is 21 to 45, initially it could be longer, that is nearing 45. And as the girl, you know, moves forward from first 3 to 4 years of her menarchial time to as her age increases, cycle becomes more regular. And then again, at the last of, you know, her reproductive potential, we know in the premenopausal years, the gap increases again because of anovulation kicking in again. And basically, abnormal uterine bleeding is that occurs outside the normal range, and which includes either absence of menses, that is having no periods, menses at irregular intervals, that is falling outside the window of, you know, either happening more frequently than 21 days or less frequently than every 45 days. They're excessive in duration, that is more number of days, more than 7 days. And the bleeding as such is heavy. HMB in itself, as Dr. Mane said, is significant thing because the volume of flow. And what volume of flow is significant? Normally we say anything around 30, 35 ml is normal, more than 80 ml is more. But can we quantify this blood loss into mls? Most of the time, no. Neither can the girl nor can the physician find out. So the best way to define it is when it interferes with the quality of life, either physical, emotional, social, and or material life. Even intermenstrual or breakthrough bleeding will fall under the category of abnormal uterine bleeding. There are two girls I would like to talk about. This is case one. I saw her 3 months back or so. She's a 19-year-old girl, BMI of 35, sedentary lifestyle, came with complaint of dizziness and fainting. She had history of continuous bleeding for last month, which was associated with passage of clots on most of the days. On examination, pallor was there, pulse was 110, BP was 90 by 16, and she had report in her hand of hemoglobin of 6 grams per deciliter. I'll be coming to her case later. She did have some features of you know, excessive hair growth on the chin. She was obese, as you can see. And you know, finally, what we did for her, we'll be talking at the end again. Another girl was a 12-year-old girl who attained menarche 6 months back and came with the complaint of prolonged flow days lasting 18 to 21 days during menses, and bleeding restarts after a gap of 7 days again. She, her vitals were stable, pulse was 84, BP was 110-70, very mild pallor, and breast and pubic hair development was Tanner stage 3. Coming to causes of, you know, abnormal uterine bleeding, to the cases, I'll be coming back again at the end that finally what did we do for them, and we'll be better informed when we, you know, come at the end of our talk. So to enumerate the causes, we all know the palm coin classification, which includes the structural causes and then the hormonal, you know, non-structural causes. So palm is the polyp, adenomyosis, leiomyoma, malignancy, hyperplasia. These are the causes. And among the non-structural causes, coagulopathy, ovulation dysfunction, endometrial, iatrogenic, and not yet classified. Actually, adolescent age group falls in two major categories, coagulation disorders and ovulation dysfunction. And we'll be talking in more detail about both of them. This is a further detailed, you know, list of causes for AUB. Important thing to remember is it could be just immaturity of the hypothalamic axis causing anovulatory uterine bleeding, or there could be other causes of ovulatory dysfunction like thyroid dysfunction, hyperprolactinemia, hypothalamic or pituitary disease, sometimes adrenal disease, diabetes, estrogen secreting ovarian tumors, or primary ovarian insufficiency. Sometimes adolescent could be on medication, antipsychotics, antidepressants, or hormonal contraception, which we need to take the history for, or corticosteroids for that matter. And then there are bleeding disorders. Commonest among them are Wall-Willebrand disease, or sometimes liver disease also could be a cause, and thrombocytopenia, which could be ITP or aplastic anemia. And as I said, structural uterine problems fall below these two major categories that are there. And then there could be non-uterine causes, which we always must keep in mind, especially if there is any history of trauma or there are signs suggestive of trauma. We should be looking at vulval causes or vaginal issues like foreign body or trauma or vaginitis being there. In the cervix, it could be a hemangioma, polyp, cervicitis, ovarian cysts sometimes present with bleeding. And, we as gynecologists sometimes forget to look at GI tract abnormalities that could be there, or urinary tract issues that may be there. Things like hemorrhoids may be bleeding, which could be taken for, heavy menses or vascular malformation or rectal prolapse, and they should be looked for as well. Commonest causes, as I said, are anovulatory cycles. Pregnancy, yes, always needs to be ruled out in young girls also, as ma'am said, Dr. Anita, that how she, a girl presented with pregnancy fully dilated, and we must keep that in mind. So bleeding disorders is another thing which 20% of the adolescent, if they present with heavy menstrual bleeding, the cause could be a bleeding disorder, which could get easily missed. Then PCOD, thyroid dysfunction, these are all ovulatory dysfunction causes also, or hypothalamic dysfunction, which could be stress, a very common issue in present times. Exercise, or too much of exercise or lack of exercise, underweight or overweight, and acute weight loss, which is always, I think, of major interest to adolescents. They want to look thin and beautiful. The look becomes a very important aspect for them as they grow. Whether they are on hormonal or intrauterine contraception, which may be taking irregularly, could be a cause of irregular bleeding too. And sometimes infection, PID, can present a picture like this, and so should always be ruled out. Common bleeding disorders, as I already said, von Willebrand disease and certain platelet disorders are something that are to be kept in mind. And I'll be coming to how we as gynecologists can still look for the basic stuff. And when we feel that, okay, we are suspecting a bleeding disorder, we include a hematologist into the picture and do a referral with them to understand any of these bleeding disorders. There are some important questions that we should ask to quantify the amount of blood loss that there is. How often does she change her sanitary pad or tampon during peak flow days? Does she change the pad or tampon during night? How large are any clots that are passed? Has a medical provider told her that she is anemic? What is normal in this? Important to remember is if somebody changes a pad or a tampon at less than 3 hourly intervals, if more than total of 21 pads or tampons are used in each cycle, if she's changing tampon or pad at night once or twice, if the size of the clot is larger than 1 inch, and if she's anemic, all these factors could mean that there is heavy menstrual blood loss. So I think 5 points to remember in this, that the interval, number of pads, nighttime changing, size of the clots, and anemia. History can give us a lot of clues regarding the cause for her heavy menstrual bleeding. One is age at menarche. Early age is associated with shorter time to establish ovulatory cycle. Late the age of starting of menarche, later the ovulatory cycles come. So if somebody starts at 11, she's expected in 50% cases to have ovulatory cycles by 12 and a half, 13 years of age. But if somebody starts menarche at 15, it has been seen that it may take even 5 to 6 years for actually the ovulatory cycles to establish, and 19 years is the age, if still she's having an ovulatory cycle, we start looking at other causes, that why is that happening. happening. Then menstrual pattern needs to be seen in great detail and will give us a lot of clues to the cause. Events coinciding with menstrual pattern, you know, like weight loss, stress, recent change in her habits, joining a college, changing places, moving to hostel, all these factors will also give us clues to is it dysfunction of the hypothalamic ovarian axis. When did the abnormal bleeding start? You know, if the first cycle after menarche is heavy and led to anemia or led to orthostatic hypotension syndromes, we could be looking at bleeding disorder. And that's a very important clue that how the initial periods have been. Sexual history, if she's sexually active, one needs to, you know, take that history sometimes in private, sending the mother out when for on the pretext of a full examination maybe, but yes, taking her into confidence and looking for if she's on contraception, has she taken irregularly, is she been using eye pills, which is seen very commonly in present days, any history of sexually transmitted infection. It has been seen that in sexually active adolescent, chlamydia infection is the commonest that is seen, and it happens quite early in their sexual career, which could be a cause for heavy bleeding in these cases too. Past medical history, any liver disease, renal disease, any history of transplant, any medication like antidepressants or drugs like aspirin, which affect coagulation, or valproic acid, that history needs to be elicited as well. When the review of system is being done, history of bruising, epistaxis, bleeding gums, any post-operative bleeding history is very important. Orthostatic symptoms as fainting, dizziness because of hypovolemia or significant blood loss need to be taken. Weight loss, weight gain can give us a clue on all the hypothalamic dysfunction, endocrine disorders, abdominal pain, fever, vaginal discharge, again, PID or endometritis. If dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia is there, one should look for endometriosis. Galactoria, heat or cold intolerance, fatigue, visual changes, headache, hirsutism, acne, again point towards endocrine issues for the cause of heavy bleeding. And bowel bladder complaints, we look for extra uterine cause of bleeding. Joint hypermobility, joint dislocations, hyperextensible skin, collagen disorders, which may be associated with bleeding abnormalities, and can give a huge clue to these things. And changes in hair, skin, nails, again, suggestive of endocrine or thyroid dysfunctions. Because bleeding disorder, you know, the window of opportunity is when she presents for the first time with heavy bleeding. That is when we should be thinking about bleeding disorders. And as I said, 20% of the adolescents with heavy menstrual bleeding would have a bleeding disorder sitting in the background. This is a very good screening tool by ACOG, which I found really pertinent. Certain questions that she can be asked: how many days did your period usually last from the time of bleeding begin until it stopped? So, you know, the 7 days, flooding or gushing during the period, did she have bleeding which required, you know, changing the napkin or the tampon every 2 hours or less? Have she ever been treated for anemia? Has anyone in the family been diagnosed with a bleeding disorder? Has ever a tooth been extracted in which there was heavy bleeding and bleeding did not stop easily? Was there any other surgery despite the dental surgery? And was there any bleeding problem after the surgery? Has she ever been pregnant? And has there ever been a history of delivery or miscarriage, and along with that, a bleeding, significant bleeding problem like PPH? And how to use this screening tool? This would be considered positive if one out of the following 4 criteria are met. The duration of menses is greater than or equal to 7 days, and women reported either flooding or bleeding through the tampon in less than 2 hours. If there was history of treatment for anemia, if there was history of diagnosed bleeding disorder in the family, and if there was excessive bleeding with tooth extraction, delivery or miscarriage or surgery. So only 4 points that we need to keep in mind. People who are diagnosed with bleeding disorder, it is good to make this pictorial blood loss assessment chart with them, charting out the amount of blood flow. And if there is minimal soakage of the pad, 1 point, if medium, 5 points, and if fully soaked, 10 points. Same goes for the tampons. And if the total score in one period is more than 100, that is significant blood loss happening. But if somebody diagnosed with this, can also be used for follow-up, because once diagnosed with a bleeding disorder and then you want to follow up, say after 6 months to 1 year, of how treatment has worked for her, again, a pictorial blood loss assessment chart she's asked to make, and then the score is counted and seen the benefit of the treatment that she has been offered. While examining an adolescent, actually from head to toe, there is so much that can be seen, which can give us evidence to the cause of her heavy bleeding. Measurement of height, weight, and arm span, Turner's, you know, it would suggest us of Turner's. Visual assessment of body habitus, fat distribution, suggestive of Cushing's, if there is central obesity, with thinning of arms, thinning of skin, blue stripe, etc. Orthostatic vital signs will give us an idea of anemia and heavy bleeding. Thyroid should be looked for. Lymph nodes should be looked for, which could be a sign of malignancy. Androgen excess features like hirsutism, acne, male pattern balding, all to be looked for. Evidence of easy bruising or oozing gums could suggest a bleeding disorder. Sometimes bruising can also be suggestive of anemia and subsequent, you know, easy bleeding because of associated reduced hematocrit. And examination of the hair and skin for thinning, dry hair, excessive sweating, acanthosis nigricans, or signs of abnormal bleeding, as I said, petechiae bruising, should always be noted. Abdomen should always be palpated in these girls to look for pregnancy, uterine, or an ovarian mass. It is also important to look for extra uterine sources of bleeding, like trauma, vulvar lesions, or signs of sexually transmitted infection. Staging should always be done for the breast, Tanner staging, for the breast, for the pubic hair, and if a girl is presenting with menorrhagia or heavy menstrual bleeding, at least Tanner stage 3 association should be seen, because that is something which points towards that adequate estrogenization of the body has taken place, and these could be anovulatory cycles that we are looking at. Pelvic ultrasound is so easily available in present times with us. I think, you know, should definitely be done before even an examination is to be thought of, and can point towards, you know, outlet obstruction, leiomyomas, ovarian mass, sometimes PCOD, and a lower abdominal ultrasound can be done if the girl is not sexually active, instead of a trans vaginal ultrasound, and would give us a lot of clues on the cause. Lab investigations, pregnancy tests should always be done. Sometimes that's the tricky part. The parent may not be agreeable when she comes with heavy bleeding. Sometimes, you know, getting a beta HCG done along with the hemoglobin that you're going to get done does the trick. Thyroid, TSH, screening for sexually transmitted infections, prolactin levels, if she especially has history of headaches and a breast complaint, and if her overall picture suggests PCOD, she's obese, she has features of hirsutism, it is a good idea to do testosterone and DHEAS levels. CBC with peripheral smear, coagulation panel at least, fibrinogen levels, and if one is suspecting bleeding disorder, which I said, as you know, if we take the thorough history, we can suspect at the time she presents for the first time. And this is the best time to actually send these samples also, plasma von Willebrand factor antigen, von Willebrand factor activity, and factor 8 activity. Why? Because once if you give her exogenous estrogen to stop the bleeding, this can spuriously elevate von Willebrand factor levels to normal range, and you will be unable to detect the bleeding disorder lying in the background. It would just delay the diagnosis. And hematology referral, if you know one is suspecting bleeding disorder in these cases. Approach to diagnosing the cause of the bleeding could be first classify the bleeding pattern, whether it is amenorrhea or irregular bleeding or prolonged or heavy bleeding, or intermenstrual bleeding. I'll not be touching on amenorrhea today, but majorly we'll talk about heavy menstrual bleeding in or irregular bleeding in the adolescent age group. Goals of management are, first is hemodynamic stability, then is correction of the acute or chronic anemia, return to a pattern of normal menstrual cycles, preventing the recurrence of this event happening again, and prevention of long-term consequences of anovulation like anemia, infertility, or endometrial cancer. I want to show this chart to just show that menarche starts after the peak height velocity is attained during puberty. And why that is important? Because one of the key elements of treatment in menorrhagia or heavy menstrual bleeding is estrogen, and high dose estrogen which sometimes may need to be given. And we always have this worry at the back of our mind, or the parent may show this worry, that the height would stop once the hormones are started. But 95% of the height gain has already happened when the menarche starts. So one should not hesitate in starting hormonal treatment if that is what is required to control the bleeding in this age group. Now, one can classify anovulatory, as I said, two major causes, anovulatory and bleeding disorders. And to treat these, one can classify into three major categories. One is mild, moderate, and severe. Mild means longer than normal 7 days menses are lasting. Could have shorter cycle, less than 24 days, but hemoglobin is usually in the normal range or maybe mildly decreased, and the flow may be slight or moderately increased. Moderate flow bleeding is when it's prolonged for more than 7 days. Menses happen every 1 to 3 weeks with moderate to heavy flow, and hemoglobin is around 10 or slightly more than 10. Severe it when it falls below 10. There are disruptive menstrual cycle with no pattern really, with heavy flow, and it may have hemodynamic instability presenting along with it. So coming to mild anovulatory bleeding, most of the girls with mild anovulatory bleeding, meaning having hemoglobin around 10 to 12 or nearing 12, observation can also be offered because we know the initial cycles could be anovulatory, or she can be offered hormonal treatment. Generally, observation and reassurance works well. You can initiate oral iron if HB is between 10 to 12 milligram per deciliter, and she should be followed up over a period of 3 to 6 months. Coming to moderate anovulatory bleeding, again, oral iron therapy is the first thing that we need to start in these patients, because we know the hemoglobin is anyways near 10, that is, she's sitting on more bleeding. She would fall into the category of severe anovulatory bleeding and would may require, you know, further measures like blood transfusion or IV iron now to bring her hemoglobin up. So treatment depends on whether the patient is currently bleeding or not. If she is not bleeding currently, then, and she doesn't want contraception. If she wants contraception, she can be started on combined oral contraceptive pills, which can be started in, you know, because she is not bleeding, they can be started in a regular manner once daily and continuously can be given for up to 3 months, three cycles without stopping in between. And then a period of, you know, 3 to 4 days is given when the shedding can take place and one can assess how the further cycles go. If she does not want contraception, one can put her on progesterone only medication like norethindrone acetate, DOB5, 5 milligrams once daily for 5 to 10 days every month. It's a good idea to start from the first of the month so that she knows she has to take it for first 10 days of the month. The bleeding would start 3 to 4 days after that, should happen within a week after that. And that's how her cycles will stay regular, taking this progesterone every month at the start. Micronized progesterone is another option, which is closer to the natural progesterone that the body releases. And that also can be taken once daily for first 10, 12 days per month. Third is medroxyprogesterone acetate, again, 10 milligram per day and can be taken for 5 to 10 days per month. Now, if this girl presents with active bleeding happening, one option could be to start her on tranexamic acid, especially if hormones are refused, or she can be started on combined oral contraceptives, or the other option is progestin only therapy if there is contraindication to estrogen, like history of migraine with aura, SLE, or estrogen secreting tumors. How can the bleeding be stopped in these moderate bleeding cases is one combined oral contraceptive pill containing at least 30 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol pill taken 8 hourly for first 48 hours or till the bleeding stops. Then making it twice daily, that is every 12 hourly one COC pill for next 48 hours, and then moving on to once daily for a total of 21 days, and then stopping and letting a withdrawal period happen. Severe anovulatory bleeding, if is happening, this could be an indication for hospitalization. What are the specific indications? If there's hemodynamic instability like tachycardia, hypotension, orthostatic vital signs, hemoglobin is less than 7, there is symptomatic anemia like fatigue and lethargy. This would require need for IV conjugated estrogen in many cases. So she requires admission for that. If there seems to be a need for blood transfusion, yes, less than 7, she requires blood transfusion. And if there's need for surgical intervention, which is mostly not required and sometimes very rarely may be needed, especially with bleeding disorders. Now, how can we manage this acute heavy bleeding or severe bleeding that's happening? We have various choices. I think in our scenario, tranexamic acid is the first thing that is tried, and up to 1.3 gram orally, 3 times a day can be given. And a total of 5 days, every 8 hour lead can be given. Conjugated equine estrogen coming with the name of Premarin IV can be given 25 milligram every 4 to 6 hours for 24 hours or till bleeding stops. Or one can start with, if she's accepting orally, one can start with combined oral contraceptive pills, monophasic combined oral contraceptive pills, anything from 30 to 50 microgram. 50 is better, of course, than 30 for stopping acute bleeding and can be given then every 6 to 8 hours until cessation of bleeding. Important thing in this is that when she started on combined oral contraceptive, there's a lot of nausea that may happen. And prophylactically, one can give ondansetron just prior to giving the combined oral contraceptive pill. Before every pill, it can be given. Another option is starting progesterone, that is metroxyprogesterone acetate, 20 milligram orally, 3 times a day. Not 10 milligram twice daily, it's 20 milligram 3 times a day for minimum of 7 days or till bleeding stops, and then it can be tapered off. Now, severe anovulatory bleeding, if does not require admission, one can manage it on an OPD basis also. Progesterone-only pills is generally first-line choice where estrogen is contraindicated. Otherwise, estrogen works the best to stabilize the endometrium for the fresh endometrium to grow and the broken endometrium to repair itself. But if a girl has migraine with aura, if there's history of SLE or a liver disease or thromboembolic disease or estrogen-dependent tumors, she's a candidate for progesterone-only pills. Now, I know it's a busy flowchart, but it's a beautiful flowchart which gives us information on, how to manage. First is, assessing the patient on physical examination and with the history and sending the sample like beta HCG, CBC, thyroid. It's like revising what we have till now talked about. And if she's bleeding actively and there is profuse bleeding and hemoglobin is less than 7 or 8 and hematocrit is less than 25, can we treat her outpatient? If no, then she requires inpatient management and we may need to consult a hematologist, and also one needs to send tests for bleeding disorders as well. Consider blood transfusion if she's hemodynamically unstable. And otherwise, if one feels that she's hemodynamically stable, not keen on admission, then she can be managed on an outpatient basis with high dose of combined oral contraceptive pill, that is every 4 to 6 hourly. And she's called back within 7 days to see any improvement. If no improvement, yes, she may require admission. Only if there is contraindication to estrogen, start with progesterone, high dose medroxyprogesterone acetate, that is 20 milligram thrice daily, that means 60 to 80 milligram per day till bleeding stops, and then tapering it, or estrogen therapy in the form of combined oral contraceptive pills or IV Premarin, and then continue it every 4 to 6 hourly till bleeding stops, and then starting the tapering. And of course, as I said, antiemetics should be started in these cases. Bleeding stops, patient can be discharged. Bleeding doesn't stop, add an antifibrinolytic like tranexamic acid, hematology opinion. Sometimes one may need to do balloon tamponade in these cases. Maintenance therapy after acute treatment needs evaluation and starting on various hormonal preparations for some time so that she does not bleed again after stopping the medication. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs is another option which can be given, which reduces bleeding to some extent, almost 25% reduction in bleeding, but should not be given in girls with bleeding disorders, and that should always be ruled out. Oral iron, until her iron stores are restored, which can be seen by normal ferritin. Sometimes these girls may get constipation because of the high dose, progesterone plus the oral iron she's being given. So stool softeners should also be considered in these cases. And then tapering of the hormones that were started initially from 6 to 8 hourly to 12 hourly and then once daily till one wants to improve hemoglobin. And so continuous COC can continue without tapering for a minimum of 3 months. And then it can be stopped. She gets a heavy period and then can be restarted on COC depending on her requirement. Progesterone only taper also is similar. Initially she was being given metroxyprogesterone every 4 to 6 hours or norethindrostat 20 milligram every 8 hours and then tapering it after the bleeding gets controlled to 12 hourly and eventually once daily till we do not desire a period. Though breakthrough bleeding happening is more with progesterone only medication. Long-term management is very, very important in these cases. You don't want to go back to stage of anemia and inability to cope with day-to-day life. So after the acute control, what we do depends on what we used initially to treat that acute episode of bleeding. So we need to look at our initial hormonal regime, whether patient needs contraception or not, and whether she's still anemic or not. So if initial control with estrogen containing regime was done and hemoglobin is more than 10, then cyclical combined oral contraceptive pills can be given for next 3 to 6 months, anywhere between 30 to 50 micrograms of estradiol. And it's important to maintain a menstrual calendar in these cases. If HB is less than 10, then combined oral contraceptive pills can be given continuously for 3 months. After that, cyclically for another 3 months and meanwhile maintain the menstrual calendar and of course the oral iron continues. If initial control was with oral progestin and she still does not desire contraception, cyclic progestin, as we had discussed, that each cycle first 10 days to 12 days of the month, she's given either norethindrone or norethisterone or micronized progesterone. And the next 20 days, she's not taking any hormone. And then again, in the next cycle, she gets 10 days of progesterone. But if there is no bleeding on stopping the pills after 7 days also, it needs further evaluation. There could be a pregnancy or there could be an endocrine dysfunction that one needs to rule out. But if she desires contraception, then there are various choices she has, like, LNG IUCDs, depomedroxyprogesterone acetate, or progestin implants, which can be given. Now, follow-up schedule could be if the bleeding was mild, she needs a review at 3 to 6 months. If it was moderate, she may need a review at 3 months. If it was severe, call her at 2 weeks if she was hospitalized. Then again at 1 month, if she was not hospitalized. And if irregular bleeding persists at 3 months or recurs after discontinuation of hormonal therapy, this is the time to do an endocrine evaluation, which in fact can be done sooner if there are signs suggesting of PCOD or Cushing's or thyroid, etc. And the endocrinology evaluation includes FSH, LH, prolactin, DHEAS, 17-hydroxyprogesterone, 3 and total testosterone, TSH and fasting insulin and glucose. Now coming back to actually after this are those two cases. So if we go back to, our case one, this girl. So this girl was 19 year old. She had a BMI of 35 with a sedentary lifestyle and had dizziness and fainting with a hemoglobin of 6. She definitely needs admission. She needs to be put on hormonal medication to control her bleeding. But because she presented with orthostatic symptoms also, it's a good idea to at least send coagulation profile with CBC, with the thyroid, and maybe the hormonal profile once she stabilizes. And bleeding disorders, fibrinogen levels, platelet count, and von Willebrand factor activity needs to be sent in her case. Pallor was present, pulse was, but now the same girl has symptoms of, hirsutism, hair growth on the upper lip or on the chin. So she could be prolonged you know, an ovulatory cycle because of PCOD. When further history was taken from her, she actually had a amenorrhea lasting for 6 months, and then she had had this period which led to a month of bleeding, which led to orthostatic symptoms in her. She was given 2 units of, you know, blood transfusion, and she was put on high dose estrogen followed by, you know, continuous combined oral contraceptive pills. And after she had settled down, 2 weeks later, she was called back to the hospital. Her evaluation for her PCOD status was done, and she was advised accordingly for lifestyle modification, weight loss, exercise, and the changes that need to be brought. And when she came back after 6 months of this episode, she had lost around 5 kgs, which was very good for her. And she was happy with continuing with combined oral contraceptive pills, and in fact intended on doing so for another 6 months. So this was one girl who had an ovulatory dysfunction because of the background picture of PCOD and obesity. This is a very different case. In this, and why we should be thinking of an ovulatory dysfunction because of certain background causes, was she was already 19. She had had these years after menarche when her periods should have settled down, but they hadn't, and there were comorbid conditions associated with her. Now in the second case, this is a girl who just had menarche 6 months back and was having heavy flow days, probably because of immature HPO axis, and the bleeding would restart again. She's a person with moderately heavy bleeding, but otherwise stable vital signs, and her Tanner staging corresponded with her, you know, menarchial status. So she was first actually put on tranexamic acid and responded to that. Her mother was not keen to start her on hormonal therapy, and she actually responded just to hemostatic agents. So this is just to get an idea of how, you know, we will manage these different cases when they come to us. And I think with this, you know, I come to the end of my talk. Thank you for patient listening. This is the menstrual record chart, which everyone actually should have. And, you know, we should give a printout of these, and one can keep photocopies. Or there are these smart apps that are there for maintaining the period, which can tell us how effective the treatment regime has been in these cases.
Very nice, Payal. Over to Dr. Mala and Dr. Sujata for their comments. Very excellently explained.
Dr. Payal, that is really very informative, exhaustive, and interesting deliberation on AUB in the adolescent girl. We have to take care of our girls and treat them, investigate them, diagnose them, and treat them appropriately, because this is the best time for us to take care of these young girls, and that will decide their future, what will they be and how they will behave in the future times. Because if they are having some coagulation defects, they have to be tackled very early, diagnosed early and tackled properly. If they are having hormonal problems, their lifestyle modification has to be done. Thanks, Dr. Payal. That was really very informative, and I'm sure all the delegates have really gained from your scientific deliberation.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your encouragement.
Dr. Sujata wants to add anything? Dr. Sujata? Or Achala ma'am wants to add anything? So if there are not any more comments from chairpersons, Nikita, we can go to the second part of our academic session.
Sure, ma'am, sure. Thank you, Payal ma'am, for this wonderful presentation. Indeed, it was very much informative for us. Now, proceeding with our second session. The second session, the topic is anemia and teenage pregnancy. For this, I would like to invite our respected chairpersons, Dr. Rakesh Taneja, sir. Good evening, sir. Sir has worked in CHS and RML Hospital and has been in private practice in West Delhi from 1997 onwards. Sir has been involved in various activities of DMA, IMA, AOGD, and he has been working on issues of health, environment, and welfare of the society. And presently, he is the president of the IMA Outer West Branch, Delhi. Sir, I welcome you for this session. Our next chairperson for the session is Dr. Anita Rajoria, ma'am. We have already welcomed ma'am. Ma'am, now I would request Dr. Rakesh Taneja, sir, to please introduce our speaker for this session, Dr. Panchamprit Kaur. Sir, please, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Nikita.
Thank you, sir.
Today's topic is anemia and teenage pregnancy. And if we really understand the load, 500 million of the world's population is a teenager. And is this adolescent age where we have more than 50% of the weight gain, 50% of the adult skeletal mass gain, and around 20% of the height gain that takes place. And all this leads to an increase in iron requirement due to expansion of blood volume and onset of menses. And if we add pregnancy load with it, the chances of anemia increase. And when we talk about teenage pregnancy, POXO comes to our mind immediately. And to deal with this interesting and exhaustive topic, we have Dr. Panchamprit Kaur, who is a gynecologist in Sitaram Bharti Institute. And she's an alumnus of Army Hospital R&R. She's a university topper in obs and gynae during graduation. And she's done a senior residency from VMMC Safdarjung Hospital as well as Gangaram Hospital. And she has taken a certified training course in gynae-onc from Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. Now I request Dr. Panchamprit Kaur to take over, please.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the warm introduction. Thank you, Dr. Anita and Dr. Nikita, for giving this opportunity to me to discuss about these two hot topics. So I will just share my screen. Yeah, is it visible?
Yes.
Okay.
You can make it full screen, dear.
Yeah, 1 second. Yes, so I was recently going through these articles in the newspaper and on the net. I wondered, actually, 1/3 of all the women of reproductive age group are actually anemic. And if we see the Indian scenario, the prevalence of anemia among adolescent girls is 56%, which is to the tune of 64 million girls at any single point in time. There were some news articles on child marriages, teenage pregnancies, school dropouts, and the effect of pandemic, what it has on the girls, who have been affected mostly. And how are the Indian laws? Do they need to rethink on the tough laws or how to go about it? Is it a cause of shame or poverty or illiteracy? Is it a cause of concern? So I thought, why not bring these two topics together in this today's talk on adolescence, a time of opportunities and woes. It should be better caught in time, rather missed. That is what the motto should be. Adolescence is a gentle, futile period, like a plant who grows its roots and gradually turns out into the full-fledged tree with roots extended deep into the soil. Another example, like a foundation stone of a building is laid. So if the foundation of the tree or the foundation of the building is strong, so the future building or the future tree will have its roots stronger and a strong base with much better development in future. Going to the similar concept, adolescence is the same foundation stone taking a turn from childhood to adulthood. So coming on to my first topic, that is understanding anemia. My objective of today's talk will be to identify the importance of anemia and adolescence, revisiting the basics, to bring in the national initiatives by the government to address anemia through a comprehensive approach, and qualms and challenges associated with teenage pregnancy. Let's have a reality check. Anemia has spread. It has become a global concern. It is not seen, it is missed. So if we see, India comes in the severe zone. More than 40% prevalence is seen in India and the subcontinent. It is a critical health concern that affects women and children throughout the life cycle. And we will be targeting the adolescence period, which is 10 to 19 years of age. As said, it marks the onset of puberty, the physical growth, the growth of the human body, the reproductive maturation of a girl or the boy, the cognitive skills of them, the functional ability, There's a whole lot of metabolic transformation that goes on in the body. There's a hormonal play inside the body. Along with this, the physical and the lifestyle habits of the person, they affect the nutritional needs of the person, maybe a girl or a boy, and the eating habits. They have an effect in toto on the overall development of an adolescent. And adolescent girls, they are at physiological stress more so due to menstruation at this, because the pubarchy starts, the menarche starts. So the nutritional status of adolescents in India, if we see the overall picture, it's 24% they are thin for age, 5% may be overweight, and 40% of the girls and 18% of the boys are anemic. Maintaining nutritional health is of utmost importance for the optimal growth and preventing future health-related problems. Why are we so much concerned about anemia? Why are we so much concerned about the low hemoglobin? Anemia, as we are all aware, that is because of the low hemoglobin, which carries oxygen and reduced tissue perfusion capacity it reduces. So it is not only the iron deficiency, there are a whole plethora of causes which can be contributing to anemia. Yes, I don't deny the fact that the major chunk of the contribution is from the nutritional, but yes, almost 60%, they are because of the other causes as well. If we see, first of all, the growing demands of the adolescents, then worm infestations like the hookworm infestation. As discussed in the previous talk by Dr. Pyle, persons might have abnormal bleeding or heavy bleeding. Menstruation per se, even if normal, it can add on to the depletion of the stores of the body. Then teenage pregnancies and early pregnancies in adolescents, they add on to the anemia. And yes, nutritional, not only iron and iron deficiency, but also other nutritional deficiency like folic acid deficiencies, vitamin C, vitamin B12, they add on to it. So anemia per se results either due to the poor dietary intake of iron or low bioavailability of iron, which can be because of the habitual intake of cereal-based diet, which are high in phytates, poor consumption of iron enhancers like vitamin C, or dietary deficiency of multivitamins as said. If you see the dietary iron requirements throughout the life cycle of a man and a woman, we see that the peak is somewhere, yes, the pregnancy, yes, there is a peak, but first peak we observe at around 12 to 13 years of age in both men and the woman, right? So adolescent anemia, it leads to reduced physical development. So if the person is anemic, there will be reduced overall physical development, which will result in decreased work output, reduced work efficiency, the capacity to focus, the capacity to work to his full, whatever the capacity is there, increases in the vulnerability of infections. So anemia results in infections. Infections per se again result in anemia. So it forms a vicious cycle. Anemia results in impaired sexual and reproductive development, like irregular menstruation. There are low pre-pregnancy iron stores. If the person is anemic, they will end up with a pregnancy in the later life with the same stores, and it forms a vicious cycle again. They will have preterm delivery. The chances of low birth weight babies are high in these patients. Anemia also results in reduced cognitive development, like diminished concentration on work, disturbance in perception, and poor learning ability. The ability to focus on work, everything goes for a toss. So there are certain cutoff values of hemoglobin for the diagnosis of anemia, which have been given by the WHO. So in adolescents, we take it as 12. Even in the children from 6 to 14, and in the adolescents from 10 to 19, we take as 12. In Indian girls, as I mentioned before, the highest prevalence of anemia is reported between the ages of 12 to 13 years, which also coincides with the average age of menarche. If we see how anemia is classified, I know everyone must be aware, but the PGs and the UGs, they might be benefited by this slide, which shows that the mild anemia, it ranges from 10 to 11.9. Moderate is from 7 to 9.9. Severe is less than 7 among the adolescent age group. Everyone is aware of the signs and symptoms like feeling lethargic, shortness of breath, increased susceptibility, history of pica, pallor, or cold feet, cold hands. We can diagnose with a simple hemoglobin test, but yes, a peripheral smear in addition to it will add on to the diagnosis. Also, not to rule out, there are many other causes like thalassemia, sickle cell anemias. So a peripheral smear will help into the diagnosis of that, and HB electrophoresis if possible. This slide, I would, for the UGs and the PGs, this was a very important point that we should not stretch the palm and see the signs of pallor. It is, we just have to compare the palm straight as compared to any other palm, your palm or any other child or siblings. See for the signs on the nail bed or the tongue or the conjunctiva, the lower lid. So there is an intergenerational cycle. The adolescent, they enters the reproductive age group with low iron stores. It leads on to the pregnant woman with anemia, with who will have a baby with low iron and hemoglobin levels, who will further have uncorrected anemia in infancy and childhood if not corrected. And if not checked, then the adolescent with low iron and hemoglobin levels and menstrual blood loss. So it forms a vicious intergenerational cycle. So it should be stopped and checked before it progresses. So what next? There is a road to prevention. There is a road to prevention on which we can actually prevent and make a halt. So it is not a single person. It is not that only I or you or a single person can work and then abolish or eradicate anemia. It is a team approach, and a team starts from the grassroots to the tertiary level. It starts from the ANMs, it starts from the Anganwadi workers, the healthcare providers, the doctors, the nurses, the sisters, everyone, they work as a team. This talk per se, the webinars, the health talks, the education, this everyone, it increases the awareness to reduce so that we spread the word and maximum population is addressed, and then we can take the measures as appropriate. So the first and foremost is balanced diet and healthy living. One of the great professors from Ames, they say that your diet should have all the colors, like your food should have all the colors. You can't say to a patient that your food should have so much percentage of carbohydrates or 70% of carbohydrates, 30% proteins or whatever, or this much fat. Your diet should have all the colors. It should have fruits, it should have pulses, it should have grains. You are not vegetarian, you can take non-veg. If not, no big deal. Vegetarian diet is good enough and much better than non-veg diet. So a glass of milk daily, bread, legumes, pulses, spinach, broccoli, your diet should have all the colors per se. So if I go into the details, this pic shows the sources of iron. Even if a person is poor, we can guide them to cook in an iron vessel, which is the cheapest source, in an iron vessel, they will gain iron while cooking. So the diet will have that iron. The spinach, jaggery, amla per se is the richest source of vitamin C, which adds on to the increased absorption of iron. So the government took its initiatives and it evolved gradually from the first when it started at 1970. The government started with National Nutritional Anemia Prophylaxis Program in 1970, when they distributed iron and folic acid tablets to all the adolescents, mothers, and children. Gradually, it became the National Nutritional Anemia Control Program when the emphasis it shifted from prevention to the management of anemia. And they found out that it was not only iron and folic acid, it was much more than that. It was vitamins, multinutritional, as I said. So they emphasized on the management of anemia. Gradually, in 2013, further evolution happened and it was revised and expanded to include the beneficiaries from all the age groups, and it came under the National Iron Plus Initiative Program. So they, in the adolescents, they recommend 100 milligrams of elemental iron and 500 micrograms of folic acid weekly throughout the year. Or there's another regime which says 30 to 60 milligram of elemental iron daily for 3 consecutive months in a year. So if the person is anemic, like for therapeutically, if the person is having mild anemia or the moderate anemia, the dosage is 60 milligram of elemental iron daily for 3 months. But if severe anemia, from the Anganwadi workers, they have to be referred to the first referral unit. Yes, sitting in a tertiary care center, we have to manage severe anemia with either IV iron or depending upon the clinical presentation of the patient, how are the findings, whether she needs blood transfusion or not, if she's in failure, or she can be managed, or we can actually address the cause at that moment of time. So major reason for poor compliance for IFA, iron and folic acid tablets, is adverse effects such as gastric irritation, nausea, epigastric discomfort, and constipation. And also because the initiative could not reach all the levels, all the grassroots levels. So this is a slide which shows that we saw only the decline of around 2% from 2006 to 2016 in adolescent girls. And in adolescent boys, the decrease was only 1% from 2006 to 16. So then came the weekly iron and folic acid supplementation program. It was a supervised weekly administration of the tablets with biannual, that twice a year they used to give albendazole 400 milligram. It was undertaken among all schools going adolescent girls and boys from 6th to 12th class. And those who were out of school, then only the girls, adolescent girls, were addressed. So there is a color coding of the tablets. Like in the adolescent group, the color coding is blue. There's different color code for the pregnant children, red and pink respectively. But for the adolescents, it is the blue tablet. But there were different challenges along with. Challenges like there are school leaves. Now that COVID has happened, so this all has been stopped. But again, so we have to overcome this. We have to overcome this. Sanitization should be explained. Hand sanitization, the hand hygiene, the sanitary hygiene. They should be taught about the good food practices, the good hygiene practices. So it everything comes under one blanket. Then came Anemia Mukt Bharat program. So it focused on the 6 into 6 into 6 strategy. There were 6 beneficiaries, there were 6 interventions, and 6 institutional mechanisms that came into play. Approximately 450 million beneficiaries, that is nearly 50% of the country's population, will be reached with this. So the Anemia Mukt Bharat. The Anemia Mukt Bharat. It is targeting 2022. So our target is that from 2016 to 2022, our percentage of adolescent girls who are getting affected, it should reduce from 54% to 36%. And in adolescent boys, it should reduce from 29% to 11%. So to achieve those targets, they had made a plan. So there were 6 interventions that came into play. The prophylactic iron and folic acid supplementation in the dosage, as I said, periodic deworming of the children, the adolescents, and the pregnant woman. Then there was intensified year-round behavior change communication campaign, like the webinars, the health talks, discussions among the groups. The Anganwadi workers, they used to visit home to home and then encourage, and they used to guide people accordingly. And also the role of delayed cord clamping. Ideally, the cord should be clamped at 3 minutes or maybe till the cord pulsations last. So it also helps in this. Then the testing of anemia using digital methods like digital hemoglobinometers are available in the rural areas as well. So that if there is low hemoglobin, they can be addressed there and then. Then the mandatory provision of iron and folic acid fortified foods in the foods that are provided by the Anganwadi centers. The wheat flour is fortified, the salts are fortified, so it increases the iron intake. Then, very important, that addressing the non-nutritional causes of anemia in the endemic pockets, like there can be focus of malaria, focus of tuberculosis, other viral infections, hemoglobinopathies, and also fluorosis. If the water content is high in fluoride, that decreases the absorption of iron. So these all parameters need to be addressed at that level. So 6 institutional mechanisms that came into play. There was a coordination between the intra-ministerial coordination, the advanced research anemia control, the logistics, the Anemia Mukt Bharat dashboard, and the communication with the other ministries and the National Anemia Mukt Bharat unit as well. So everything was working under collaboration. One of the main objectives, now that Anemia Mukt Bharat has come into the Poshan Abhiyan, which is designed to reduce prevalence of anemia, as said, 3% points per year among children, adolescents, and women from 15 to 14 years between the year 2018 to 2022. This month of September was a Rashtriya Poshan Maah, so that's why I was mentioning on the nutritional component very specifically. Worldwide, there have been sustainable development goals. There are 17 goals which have been demarcated by the UN. They're a collection of interlinked global goals designed to be a blueprint to achieve a better and more sustainable future for all. So in that goals, the goal 2.2 aims to end hunger, to achieve better nutrition, and there's a goal 6 that achieves better hygiene and sanitation purposes. So everything, if we work together, we might have a great future. We might obstruct this growth here and then and prevent it from going into much more other complications. Otherwise, the day is not far that we will land up from a frying pot into the fire. Coming on to my next CV, next presentation, in continuation with this, so if patients are anemic, they may if they become pregnant, they become pregnant teenagers, so all the complications, they increase. So pregnant teenagers, coming on to the second part of the presentation. At a glance, a female, if she's under 20 years of age and she becomes pregnant, that is when she's defined as to be having an adolescent pregnancy. In 2017, an estimate of 11.8 million teenage pregnancies occurred in India, which is quite high. 7.9% of women aged 15 to 19 years were already mothers or pregnant at the time of survey. This was a survey which was carried on by National Family Health, fourth part, and was updated on 19th of January. The prevalence is seen to be higher in rural areas, that is 9.2%, as compared to the urban areas. So if we see the contributory factors, there are various factors which are contributing to the teenage pregnancies. The girl suppression, the unintended, that is they are not using contraceptives, there's lack of parental care, the cultural beliefs, lack of school fees, dropouts from the schools, in the upper class, maybe drugs, alcohol, party. In the low class, there can be cause of poverty, love, desire for child, or forced marriage, low education level, peer pressure, or maybe rape. So these all factors, they contribute to the prevalence of teenage pregnancy. What are the consequences of the same? The teenage pregnancy puts young women at the risk for health issues, the economic issues, the social and financial issues. Teen mothers are likely to have health problems, including hypertension, premature labor, low birth weight babies. There is a high chance of neonatal mortality because of it perpetuates the cycle of poverty. And again, there are increased chances of postpartum depression, anxiety, there's lack of breastfeeding initiative, stress induced, and all these factors, they come into play. It is not a joke. Think twice. Be a kid and don't have one. This should be the message for the general public. So what are the Indian laws and regulations for it? Then came the POCSO Act, what a clinician should know. Any sexual activity with a child below 18 years of age, whether boy or girl, is a crime. The law says that any form of sexual contact, fingering, oral sex, etc., will also fall within the definition of rape. So teenage pregnancy under the age of 18 years is a criminal offense and needs to be reported to police. And many a times they're not even aware. A person walks with irregular spotting or irregular bleeding. And when you get the BTSG or the urine for pregnancy, maybe sometimes you even examine there is an abdominal lump and the pregnancy is there. So if the person is less than 18 years of age, it should be reported to police and then further call should be taken. Under the Child Marriage Restraint Act, it is given the right to consent post 16 years to the woman. So this 2-year discrepancy is there. So they can have pregnancy post 16 years, but if she is a married minor girl who gets pregnant and also has the legal right to consent because she's over 16, but she cannot get aborted without the permission of her legal guardian. So there are so many questions in the POCSO Act which are unanswered, but yes, there is a way forward and we might have these questions answered in future changes in the act. Caribbean government, they started with the Adolescent Pregnancy Prevention Week. So recently it crossed last week. So my take home message will be increasing in the awareness, healthy, balanced, nutritious diet, iron and folic acid supplementation, along with the multivitamin supplementation, better nutrition, good hygiene practices. Of course, prevention is definitely better than cure. Be a kid and don't have one. And adolescence is precious. Thank you.
Hello. Yes. Excellent presentation, Panchamprit. You have covered almost each and every aspect. So you want to go on with another presentation?
No, ma'am. I think I'm done.
Okay. So you have covered almost each and every aspect that a clinician should know about anemia in teenagers and as well as problems of pregnancy in teenage. So we all know that anemia has caused a red alert in India as far as adolescents are concerned. So many adolescents, they are diagnosed to be having anemia. And if we have a glance at adolescent health indicators, we must know that a girl who is between 15 to 18 years, almost 26 to 54% in that age group get married. And in India, it was seen that by the age of 20 years, almost 70% girls are married. And they achieve motherhood around 36 to 64%. In teenage only. So MMR increases to 3 to 4 times in these girls, and even infant mortality rate also jumps to 2 to 4 times. Malnutrition, as you have already highlighted, it's still a concern. It is around 40 to 45% in adolescent teenagers. So STIs, RTIs, HIV, all these are also problems which are associated with teenager sexual behavior. And of course, you have very well highlighted that Anemia Mukt Bharat Abhiyan and role of deworming. You should know that RMNCH has a now separate arm, that is plus A, RMNCH plus A. Plus A means it adds on to the concerns of adolescents. And of course, the slogan should be, Kya aapne neeli goli li? I always ask my adolescent patients whenever they come to us, I've got a poster in my OPD which asks, Kya aapne neeli goli li? Of course, COVID has caused a setback to this abhiyan of giving blue tablet in schools, but still we can make a difference if we continue to counsel our young teenagers to take iron tablets like that. Deworming is a very important aspect we have to take into consideration. So if Dr. Taneja sir wants to add anything.
I think it's been a wonderful presentation by Dr. Panchamprit. Of course, previous speaker also was excellent. And Dr. Panchamprit has covered nearly all the aspects that need to be covered. And you have very rightly buttressed it with your thoughts. I don't think anything further needs to be added to it. Thank you very much, Dr. Panchamprit, for an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Dr. Mala, you would like to say something regarding the second presentation?
Excellent presentation, Dr. Pancham. I must congratulate you. You have covered almost all the aspects of Anemia Mukt Bharat and anemia in the teenagers as well as pregnant with anemia. We have to also concentrate on guiding our young girls, what to eat, what are the lifestyle changes, and how we could help them prevent anemia in the tender age. Because if the girls are anemic, they will not be very active, neither in games, nor in studies, nor in any other activities. So we have to take care of our girls. We have to care them, nourish them, guide them that this is the right diet to take, and therefore help them to have a healthy lifestyle. If our girls are healthy, they will grow up into healthy individuals, healthy mothers, and they can look after their families and nicely in future. Thanks, Dr. Pancham.
Thank you.
A nice insight into all these aspects. And I must congratulate Dr. Anita Rajoria for organizing such an excellent webinar.
Thank you, Dr. Mala. In fact, I always tell my residents, if mothers get children to you, especially girls or boys, whatever, if they are complaining of poor school performance, just look and rule out anemia in these girls or boys, adolescent boys, because it may be the first indicator of iron deficiency. Because, we all understand that iron is an important part of all the cytochromes. When the iron deficiency is there, the whole metabolism goes haywire. And, you know, the girl may feel lassitude, less energy, poor school performance. All these may be, you know, indicators of that she's suffering from iron deficiency. So over to you, Nikita. Anybody wants to add anything or are there any questions to be answered? Ashla ma'am, would you like to say something?
I think all has been said about the presentations and they have been good and they are the need of the hour. I just wanted to, since these people have presented so well and they seem to be interested in adolescent health, so I think we should be taking the program, what our FOXI president wants to take the DIRA program forward and, you know, train these people who are interested in training the school teachers and other doctors for you know, their own safety. And to understand the good touch and the bad touch and everything, all that has to be taught. So in this, I take this opportunity that people who are interested in doing this kind of training, they can contact Anita or me and then we'll give their name to FOXI to be trained for this. This is an important aspect of adolescent health. We have to take care, you know, protection of the mental health of adolescent girls.
Definitely, ma'am. Thank you for that comment. So, Nikita, are there any questions or we call it a day now?
No, I don't see any questions, ma'am. But Dr. Sujata Das, is she here? Matlab, if she would like to add something. Sujata, ma'am, are you here, ma'am?
She had joined, but I think...
she has left, I think.
She was saying that she was having some network issues there, yes, at her end. So we can proceed to vote of thanks, Nikita. You can just give vote of thanks.
So we had very, very, very excellent presentations by both Dr. Pai.
Dr. Nikita, can I just pitch in?
Yeah, sure, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
Yeah, I was in the beginning, there was some internet issues and I was just going in and out of the meeting for at least 4-5 times. Yeah. But the second half I could attend and it was really, really a very good presentation by Dr. Parul and Dr. Pancham Preet, and I must congratulate both of them for their wonderful, very colorful, very vibrant presentations, very, very informative session. As far as the anemia is concerned, yes, again, it is a very, very relevant topic, very informative, as well as is the need of the hour. And I must congratulate both the speakers as, I mean, it was out and out subdivision team. Dr. Parul was our senior resident, Dr. Nikita is our senior resident, and Dr. Pancham Preet was a senior resident. They have all done all great jobs. Great job done. I must congratulate all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sujata. Thank you for nice comments.
Thank you, ma'am.
Nikita, over to you for vote.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, excellent presentation by both and really informative. Initially, I had thought, okay, what it would be, but seeing the response, it was really excellent. The presenters were really very good. And we have so many take-home messages from this presentation. So at the end, I would like to thank you, each and every faculty member and all the participants who joined this webinar. Very special thanks to our respected Dr. Achila Batra, ma'am, Dr. Anita Rajoria, ma'am, Dr. Sujata Das, ma'am, who has been very kind to give us the opportunities whenever we have asked for. Special thanks to Dr. Mala Srivastava, ma'am, Dr. Rakesh Taneja, sir, for their presence and their valuable words. Dr. Girish Mane, sir, has left for his some other commitments. And it was really a very proud moment for us that he was there with us. So I would like to end this session now. Let's plan more webinars in future. And I'll be in touch with the AOGD team and all of you in future. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
And my special thanks to Shivam for organizing it so well. Thank you, Shivam, for giving us this platform.
Sorry, Shivam. I missed you last time also. But yes, without your support, this would not have been possible. He's always there whenever I ping him. Shivam, please do this, please do that. And he's really there every time. Thanks, Shivam.
Thank you, all faculty, for joining. And thank you, dear delegates.
I would like to thank Sitaram Bharati Hospital team also for giving me time to prepare for this presentation today in the moment of crisis. Thank you. Thank you.
It was great, 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 really.
Shivam, photo le liya hai, photo le lo.
Ma'am, done. Maine le liya pehle.
Acha, thank you, everybody. So, Ajay, do we call it a day now?
Yeah, please. Yes.
Thank you. Thanks for joining. Bye-bye. Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Bye.
Bye, everyone.